now I give my pleasure to introduce Kevin Cotter, and he gave me a short. He's a champion in many ways. Kevin has been with Princeton for over 21 years, leading the youngest classes to the highest participation rate of any university in the country in terms of donations. Kevin studied genetics, winning Princeton's Laboratory Prize for Most Outstanding Thesis in 1996 for discovering a candidate gene for aggression. Kevin is a two-time Olympian and gold medalist world champion in rowing, but he has also launched several companies over the past decade, including a fundraising company called Rainmaker, which he co-founded with Sean Brennan. Kevin is also a concert pianist, winning several film festivals. I was serious when I said champion in many ways. He lives in Hopewell, New Jersey with his wife, Hope, and three boys. Let's welcome Kevin Cotter. Thank you.
Can you hear me? Thank you for that warm welcome. It's an honor to be talking in front of you today, because when I think about what makes like this place great, not New Jersey, but America and the world, I think of not the people that I see on CNN that are the headlights for all of these headlines for news. I think of the people that are actually doing the work in the trenches, and it's like you guys. It's the Trenton Outreach, it's Isles, it's Campfire, it's all of these great organizations. So today, I'm gonna keep my remarks very short, and I just wanna leave you with three things. So first, awkward guy with the lunchbox. This is an embarrassing photo my mom took of me on the first day of first grade. And confident and super excited to start and launch my career, get to first grade, immediately knocked down, bumped into the summer school program for remedial work, just had a very, very slow start out of the gates. Super excited about going to summer school in first grade. So my parents decide to cheer me up and they buy me a brand new BMX bicycle. And they're just like, okay, make sure you get to school and you lock it up. And I was like, okay, I'll lock it up. First day of summer school, go in, come out, get my bike. Someone stole my lock and left my bike because, because my lock was apparently more valuable than my fancy bike. So I have a 30-second conversation that day with my first grade teacher. And it was about pulling up from your bootstraps and let's like figure out how to like make this happen. And it was a very meaningful 30-second conversation that stuck with me. So fast forward a little bit later, in eighth grade, I'm washing dishes at a restaurant, trying to earn money for my family. My father had lost his job. And so I'm working illegally. And I'm having all these great conversations with older adults about the values of staying in high school. Like, why go to high school? They're just like, stay in the restaurant world. Like, it's great here. And they're just like, oh no, you seem to have promise. Maybe you should try the high school thing and go on. 30-second conversations that were in the walk-in as I was a sous chef, like learning how to make salads. It was conversations about drugs and about the pros and cons to drugs for as I'm a eighth grade, ninth grader. Then in the summers, I had to earn money for my high school. And so I took on other jobs like digging holes for fence companies. And then I was a paper boy. So my family had this, everyone had that delivered papers had like these great paper sacks. And I grew up in Buffalo, New York. And my mom was like, oh, no, I'm gonna sew you paper sacks. So she literally like made me these paper sacks. And one day in ninth grade, we're walking out and it was about 2 feet of snow. And I'm going through, walking across the lawn, and I fall backwards and I land deep into the snow. And it was dark in the morning, and I just like sat there and I didn't move. And I said, I gotta get the hell out of here. I was just like, there, the fact that this is so comforting for me to be laying in a snowbank, weighed down by these paper sacks, I was like, I gotta like make a change. So I started to talk to, this is where I start to get into athletics. I talked to some folks in ninth grade, and I was like, what sports can I do? And I come home, I was like, Mom, I think I'm gonna do cross country. And she's like, oh, that's fantastic. That's not a coordination sport. You're not great at hand-eye stuff. So this is great. Maybe you can just like, this is good. You just have to like run forward. It's like, you know, how hard could it be? And also she's thinking, I just need to buy you a pair of sneakers. That's the only equipment you need. This is great. While I was in cross country, someone came up to me and said like, hey, like, you know, do you want to try out for the rowing team? And I was just like, no, but like what's rowing? And they're just like, oh, you just like, you know, do the same thing. You row backwards and it's just, you know, you just do the same motion again. I was like, okay, fine. So I go down and I try out for this team in Buffalo, New York, have another 30-second conversation with my coach. He's like, all right, you know, you look like you might be good. Talk to my cousin. And I was like, how do I do this? And he's like, Kev, all you need to do is jump on this machine and go 8 minutes and 15 seconds for this 2,500 meter length of time. So I was like, no problem. I'll do that. So 3 years later, so I go home and I write this number, 815, on the wooden plaque or the wooden slat underneath my bunk bed. Fast forward 3 years later, I call my cousin up. I was like, fantastic news. I hit the number. And he's just like, great. What'd you get? I was like, 814. And he's just like, that wasn't the number I gave you. I said, I give you 914. And I was like, all right, like, what does that mean? Is it good or bad? He's just like, that puts you, if you can do that, that puts you number six in the world. So word gets out that there's this crazy, skinny, awkward kid with a Superman lunchbox that went 8:14. Coaches fly in to see this thing happen, and I go 8:09 in front of them, super nervous, very wanting to like get out of Buffalo, partly. And then I had another 30-second conversation with my coach, who said, he said, look, you're going to have some opportunities. Eventually, you might be on a podium, standing in front of amazing people to really help leverage their philanthropy into the world, their gift of time, their choice not to do some intense investor banking job and instead like work with the people and actually make movement. And so today is like a great day for me for that. So I thank my coach for that. It's a culmination of these 30-second conversations, which is absolutely critical. And what I'm gonna ask you to do is, next time you're in front of like a young man or young girl who's like 9, 10, 11 years old, realize that 30-second piece that you actually say to them, that could pivot their direction in life 1 or 2%, and then someone else has a 30-second conversation with them. The culmination of it is intense, and it helps build and build and build. So it was these mentors, these caseworkers, volunteers, parents, those are the people that made those 30 seconds happen. And so I'd ask you to really think about that. I'll also ask you to expand your definition of what a team is. A lot of people think a team, it's this like concerted group of people that you are with, and then it like disbands and then you move on. Team can be everyone. It can be Marge. It can be the volunteer at the front door. It can be the guy that pumps my gas, who like I strike up a 10-second conversation with. It can be that kid that comes in and really needs like someone, he needs a laugh because he's had a really, really bad day. It also could be, so I want you to expand your definition of team. That's very, very important to me. Each of these 30 seconds, like when I look out into this room and I see 550 people that care about making some difference in the world, that is where I think of sparks. That's where I think of light, not to get back to Marge's like connectivity, but that's one of the things I think about. And I asked like someone at work, I was like, when you think of light, what do you think about? And they like sent me this video, which I want to show you real quick. It was this idea of like sparks like flying. And when I think of 550 nonprofits gathered in a room, all trying to like make their movement, make their space, be that star, be that light, and make that moment. I think of this moment. I think of looking out to you guys for that. There's a philosopher who I love called Rumi, and he has this idea that your life is like a piece of light. As it goes through a piece of, let's say, stained glass, or someone like you, or you, or you, it gets bent, and it's forever changed until it reaches that next pinnacle, and then it gets bent again. Each person that it meets, it fine-tunes itself and gets closer to its core. And I want you to think of each of you as every time you have a conversation with someone, you're changing their trajectory ever so slightly, but it could set them on a direction that the next conversation they have, they're more open and more light-filled to like make a change with this. It's really important for me that you guys view yourselves in this like light-filled way, because it's very apparent when you're talking to someone and they're coming to you from a place of positive energy. And so this was a video that I found very, very, very important. So I want to talk real quickly about the mindset of an elite athlete. This is one of those things that, so you guys don't get mesmerized and like, I don't want you guys falling asleep in the dark. I wanted you to talk about like a mindset of an elite athlete. So this is the wallpaper from retro 70s that was on my bedroom wall when I grew up. And it took on new meaning as I was doing this keynote about the characters in it and how each character has like an alter ego. So they have their superhero days, and yet they have their like day-to-day persona, right? And I started to think about, as an elite athlete, I've trained in Colorado, San Diego at the Olympic Training Center, I've trained at altitude. I've done things called super compensation, where you go absolutely crazy for 2 weeks straight, where you're doing four workouts a day. And then you take like 4 days break and you don't do shit. And the reason why you do that is you're teaching your body to spike with intensity so that when you race on the end of that fourth day, you are so well rested and just ready to attack life and ready to go after it. And that's probably one of the most important mindsets of an athlete. Nothing ever works like in a straight slope for an elite athlete. You have to spike and then you have to come back down. You can't always be on. And as a fundraiser, and I'm sitting at Princeton, I realize like, holy cow, like my first year of my job, I tried to be on every single day, on, 187%, like burning the candle at 9 different ends. And it ends up diluting the impact that I was having on people. I needed to be more aware as to when I needed to have that super meaningful conversation that Marge was talking about. When is that conversation going to matter? Like be aware and be on top of that and then take it on. Don't feel you always have to be on. So that's one of the things as an elite athlete. I remember being in the Olympic Village and, you know, having tremendous downtime with athletes that are just like, they're trying to do nothing. They're not trying to talk. They're not trying to tie their shoes. They're really just focusing in on themselves. That's why when you watch TV, people are oftentimes listening to music and like in the corner of the pool or wherever they're at. They're trying to like really do nothing because they're going to have to be on and channel that spiked training at altitude mentality. So that's one of the things I wanted to talk to you guys about. So let's talk about combining these two ideas, these potent 30-second touches that you might have on someone, and this whole idea that you can't be on all the time. So when I arrived at Princeton, the youngest 10 classes at Princeton were about average with the general group. And Princeton was thrilled about that. They're like, look, it's fantastic. They're right at where they should be. And I was just like, there's more out there. I was like, there's more out there. These millennials, as much as people complain about them, like, care about causes, really care about causes. And they will give their gift of time and then some. It's just getting their attention. And so what I did was I created a program at Princeton, which I want you guys to see, because you might be able to replicate something like this on a scale, or the idea of blending these 30-second chunks of time and then clustering your effort in a small event. So I called this event the boot camp, and originally I started it in my house, and I cooked dinner for these volunteers that came back, and I said, we're gonna approach this kind of like an Olympic championship. We're gonna go gangbusters for 5-6 hours in my house, and we're gonna try and call every single alum that's in your class. So they set up war rooms. They had like multiple laptops up. They were on Snapchat. You know, they were going using technology that I had never even seen before. And it blew the numbers out of the water. This is now an event that's been going on at Princeton for 8 years. Other schools are starting to replicate it right now because it's the only thing that seems to be moving the needle. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you a video. This is the last thing I'll show you, and then I'll get off the stage, but this is a video of the boot camp, and I love slightly irreverence with like almost everything that I do in life, because I do think it helps get people's attention. It's like, so be a little bold, try and combine these clustered moments. I'll show you this video. I'll try and walk you through what this is. What I did was, I see the dawn of this is about 130 young alumni that just graduated, and they come back to like call around 5,000 people in a 5-hour period. And what I asked them to do is literally take those 30-second pockets, piece them together back to back to back. Collisions of 30-second pieces that's absolutely critical, because people feed off of it as opposed to trying to raise money by yourself in like a cubicle. Having them together actually really helped the numbers. So quantitatively, we could measure this, how many gifts per minute, how many gifts per hour were brought in when they're alone, when they're in a group. When they're in a group, about 5 hours. Leave it on that. But I want to thank Marge. I want to thank the group for coming together. This is, if this group can leverage those conversations and create a web in this community, this place is going to be better. And we need it now in the history, as far as I've been around on this planet for 44 years. We need this now probably more than ever, where everyone can like step it up just a little bit. If that's 2 extra conversations you have per week. Because of the breadth of nonprofits that you guys are involved in, this is a way, as a gift to me, that you guys can leverage this philanthropy, this force multiplier that my friend Sean Brennan always says, to help lift the whole enterprise up. And it's going to come from what's in this room. It's like so exciting for me. So as I look out, like I see 500 sparks that are all going to like bang into each other, like in these breakout sessions, and good luck.
Okay. Thank you. Have a wonderful evening connecting with people, learning, and be champions or stars. Go forth. Have good conversations. Food's on the next level.